example of a multi-component quantum field. And through the process, I would like to introduce you to the concept of polarization. And internal symmetry. Now suppose I have a three component field which is described by a Lagrangian.
Corresponding to the three components of the field.
So it is clear that pi mu sigma for this particular Lagrangian is simply given by partial mu phi sigma, correct? This is our canonical momentum. Now from the canonical momentum we can construct the Hamiltonian. So from we take the time-like component of this canonical momentum. And then we can construct the Hamiltonian for the system, the Hamiltonian density. The Hamiltonian density will be given by this term. Insert all the different fields in here, the result turns out to be just insert these values. This already has one term like this with a factor of half. So that gives me 1/2 of just the time-like component. The negative sign inside the gradient becomes a positive sign. And this is the master. So if I just insert, perform a substitution, this is the Hamiltonian that I overcame. Now I can construct the canonical commutation relationship between the fields. So I have a field phi, okay, alpha or sigma. Let's call it alpha because I would like to use a beta as well. If this is a quantum mechanical operator defined at a time t and a position x, and I form the commutator with the momentum associated to this field. For generality, let's take a beta here. Okay. Same time, possibly a different position in free space. This commutator is simply going to be equal to iota x minus y, and we also have to keep this alpha and beta the same, because the commutator between different alphas and betas vanish. So this is our canonical commutation relationship. Now what we could do, if you were to write the Hamiltonian with these quantum operators, we just put a hat over here, a hat over here, a hat over here. But we would like to start off with a mode expansion properties. Okay. So once we have a mode expansion for the fields, we can find the derivatives of those fields and put it inside the Hamiltonian and come up with a quantum field version for the Hamiltonian. Alright, so now let's try the mode expansion. This is just a usual machinery for canonical quantization. Now the mode expansion for each field is written in its conventional way. For example, phi alpha x is going to be given by dqp 2 pi 3 by 2 2 ep 1 half. Now we have phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. So if this were to be a vector, we would have a mode expansion for each of the three components. So we have A, let's call this term P1. A minus I P X plus A P1. That A plus I P for X. So first I'm going to write down the mode expansion and then I'm going to explain what this means. Then I have A P2 E minus I P plus A P dagger E plus I P for X. A P E minus I P X plus A P 3 A plus I P dot X. So now if you look at each one of these rows one by one, for the first component, which is phi 1, the mode expansion for phi 1 is just this integral. This is a Lorentz invariant measure. Then I have a creation operator corresponding to the first type of the P1. So this is a sum over, so this is an annihilation operator for the first type of P1. This is the creation operator for the first type of P1. And then you have a mode expansion in which this P can take up all possible values. Okay? So you can call this anything you like. You can call this X, S1, S2, if this P is continuous. So this corresponds to the first part, kind of part. These two creation and annihilation operators correspond to the first kind of P. These two operators correspond to the second kind of P. And these two particles correspond to the third kind of P. Okay? And these P's take up all possible values because we're summing up over all possible values, and this is the proper normalization.
On the left hand side, there's no P1, P2, P3, and C. But you're not summing over them, right?
So what we're doing is, so whenever we have a field, let's look at a single classical scalar field. Just one field. Thank you. Alright, so this is the mode expansion for a single.
Single.
Alright. Now we have these terms over here. Now P dot x, which has energy and three momentums. This also has energy and three momentums. This is an annihilation operator corresponding to the annihilation of a particle which is associated with this field. Likewise, this is the creation operator corresponding to that.
And you're integrating over this field.
And we are, in this particular case, we are indeed integrating over this field.
So even on the top, there will be P1 and then we'll be on top as well. You're integrating over what we have. Because this
right,
is
just
field of coupled.
Just a minute. Alright, so what I could do, okay, so this is just a notational convenience. So what I could do, I could put a PL. Exactly. So this is a P1. P1, P1, P2, P2, P3, P3, and this is
depending on which one you're doing.
Right. So let me write this in another fashion. This is just one component of the mode expansion. So indeed, we have to sum up over all. So if you just take the first row over here, there has to be P1 here, a P1 here, and a P1 here. Okay. Now, if we use this mode expansion over here and find out the derivative with respect to time, find out the gradient of this mode expansion, and insert into this particular age, we'll get the second quantized version, or we'll get the quantum field version for the Hamiltonian, which will just look like a sum of oscillators. In fact, this particular expression can also be written in this form. What I could do is the following. Phi A alpha is DQP. Now this is my three component field, 2 pi. 3 over 2, 2 EP, 1 half. Now I'm summing up over all, the P's, okay? And for each component, I just write a vector H alpha Now this could be a function of P. This could be a function of P. So this is a vector. And I write A P1, P alpha E minus I P dot x plus A P alpha dagger P plus I P dot x. And then I sum up over all alphas.
Dubara, you have A, you modifying the name, A H cap.
H cap, not that vector. So this is the mode expansion in compact form. What this means, I'm integrating over momentum p, and I'm summing up over alphas. Alpha equals 1, 2, and 3, and I'm going to explicitly write down what these vectors are. And I have terms, which is the mode expansion, I have the creation of p alpha, the relation of p alpha, and I have the creation of p alpha.
So if you're summing over alpha,
that's the move. So now what does this H mean? H1 is 1, 0, 0. H2 is another vector, 0, 1, 0. H3 is another vector, 0, 0, 1. Okay? So now I have these three vectors, these three H's. And if I just put in these vectors in here, I will recover what I've written.
So how can H ever depend on P?
It will not depend on P in this particular example. But it may, for example, in if you're talking about electromagnetism, it will depend on P. It may or may not depend on P. In general it does.
So because H
you could have momentum dependent. So this is a polarization. You could have polarizations that depend on P, and it does happen in electromagnetism. So we're going to look at this in one of our next classes. Yes.
Sir,
this is what this thing.
तो जब P के साथ alpha आपने remove कर दिया, देखो ऊपर expression में लिखा हुआ है, अरे ऊपर आपने जो है, ये जो
you see, I'm summing up over all momentums. Okay. Now this is okay. So the, I can reinstate those alphas, but this is just notation here. Okay. Just, I don't want to clutter my expression with so many alphas.
Does the alpha on the left hand side represent a particular component of this static vector that you're doing? So
no, this is this.
Yeah.
This just represents this vector.
The whole vector.
Yes. And this is just the mode expansion of this vector. You just compare this expression with this expression. So if you just have one field here, this is the mode expansion for a single field. If you have three components to it, you will have three components. And for each component, you will have a creation and a annihilation of it. So let's look at one more example of this. And the example that I would like to talk about, so in this particular case, what you could also do is you could find another charges, etc. So if I have, say, for example, an SO3 transformation, and I look at a rotation about the phi 3 axis, then I will know that phi 1 prime, phi 2 prime, phi 3 prime is going to be given by sum cosine theta minus sine theta 0 sine theta cosine theta. So the Lagrangian will be invariant under a transformation of this kind. So So now what I could do if I wanted to find out the error charges, I would have looked. So my theta is now a parameter. And in the small parameter, cosine theta is approximated as 1. Minus sine theta is approximated as minus theta. So I will be able to find out my d phi 1, and that will be given by minus phi 2, which is simply because phi 1 prime is phi 1 minus theta phi 2. So my d phi 1 is minus phi 2. My d phi 2 is going to be given by phi 1. And for this particular rotation, d phi 3 is 0. Now I have the momentum that is conjugate to phi 1, I have the canonical momentum conjugate to phi 2. I have this, and I multiply these together, I can find out the net charge. And I can find out the conserved Q, the conserved charge. And that conserved quantity is called the isospin. Yes?
So what's d phi 1?
So d phi 1 is defined as, so d phi 1 is defined in the following, delta phi 1 under a transformation is equal to d phi 1 and the parameter that we change. So d phi 1 is this object. And if you perform the canonical quantization, I think you should do it on your own. You learn that the Hamiltonian turns out to be equal to d2p sum over alpha ap alpha center ap alpha. So now, I think you should perform this canonical quantization on your own. Try doing it. It's a lengthy question, and one or two questions the midterm might be just perform the canonical quantization. Just run the machine, you know, and see if you can get result of this. And now, what you will observe here is that the total energy of the system is given as a sum of all momentum states with of the number of particles in each polarization mode. Now, alpha is a polarization. Because these H's that I've written over here, there are three kinds of H's. There are three kinds of polarization. One is H1, H2, and H3. Because there are three kinds of particles, AP1, AP2, AP3. So now each one of these particles, kinds of particles and antiparticles, will have energy. And you find out the number of particles in each polarization mode. And sum up of all the polarizations. In this case, we have three polarization states. Looking for the field. And this is the oscillator problem that emerges as a result of this canonical quantization. Now, I think you should do this on your own. It's not difficult at all. Now, let's look at another. As another example of this multi-component. So I'm just trying to talk about a fictitious particle called a massive photon. Now this is an example of a multi-component field. Suppose I have a Lagrangian L, which is given by minus 1 over 4 F mu mu F mu mu. Okay, now we know that this is the Lagrangian for an electromagnetic field in the absence of sources. Okay. Now to this I add a mass term. So I add a mass term with a positive sign plus half m square. Okay. A mu A mu. Suppose I add this massive term to this dimension. Now I would like to canonically quantize this. I would like to find out, is there a polarization state associated with this Lagrangian? This Lagrangian is also called the Proctor Lagrangian.
Sir?
Yes. अगर ये मैं निकाल दूँ तब गेज इंग्रेडिएंट नहीं है, या मैं यहाँ पे सोर्स डालूँ now this is an interesting toy example. So let's find out, let's build up our concepts of this multi component states and multi polarizations in by looking at this particular dimension. Now, first of all, what we would like to do is we would like to find out the Euler Lagrange equation and the equation of motion for this. So, we all know that this particular term here is given by minus 1 over 4. Now, this is partial mu a mu minus partial mu a mu, and then we up make the indices go upstairs. And this plus sign is really important. Now, if I were to find out partial L over partial mu, now this is a multi-component field, of course. So there are four components. There are four A mu's, where mu is 0, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so this is an example of a multi-component field. So I need to take the partial derivative with respect to mu of some component, say a mu. Okay? And if I apply the Euler Lagrange equation, this thing will be equal to partial L over partial a mu. So this is the Euler Lagrange equation for each mu. So if I just look at this term over here for the time, partial L, partial, I can write this as, let's put mu here. I can write this as A mu comma mu, right? We've already looked at this condition. Now what I need to do is, I need to find the derivative of this Hamiltonian with respect to A mu comma mu. This is A mu comma mu. This is the term with indices 12. And so, now depending upon whether both of these are space indices or both of these are time indices, you get a plus sign or a minus sign here. Okay, we've already looked at this in one of our moments. So this term turns out to be minus F mu mu. You can work out the algebra itself. No matter whether both mu and mu are space indices or one of them is space indices, no matter what the case is this particular result. Now if I look at the right hand side, of course I have to differentiate this with respect to mu later on. But if I look at the right hand side of the Lagrangian, I will just get terms coming out from here. Okay. So partial L by partial A let's differentiate with respect to A mu. Okay. Or we have a lower indices here, so let's be consistent. So with respect to A mu, this is half this is partial AU of half m square a nu. This is a nu, so a yod index, it becomes plus minus a nu, whether this is a space-like index or a band index. So I get a nu square. The plus sign or a minus sign. So if this is a time-like index, so I get a plus sign, if it's a space-like index, I get this thing. So I get plus minus m square a nu. Now this is a time-like index. I can raise this index without any problem. With the space-like index, I can raise this index and invert the sign. So I get plus m square a nu. Now I need to compare the left-hand side with the right-hand side. So I have minus partial mu f mu nu minus m squared a nu is 0. I have this expression over here. This is for the Broca equation. Now the nice thing that I find out from this equation is that if I take the derivative with respect to mu, this equals 0. So what is this term equal to? 0, because this is asymmetric. So this leads me to the conclusion that the divergence of A is 0. If I have a Lagrangian on that. Now this is really interesting because if I do a mode expansion of A nu and I expand this as being proportional to p raised to minus px, then I will actually get p nu A nu will be equal to 0. We're going to investigate this. Now the other thing that is interesting here is that if I look at this equation over here, this actually does resemble the Klein-Gordon equation. Let me show you how. If I take this equation over here and I just expand this term over here, I get partial mu f mu nu is partial mu a nu minus partial mu a nu plus m squared a nu equals 0. So partial mu a nu is partial square plus m squared a nu is partial mu a nu. Oh, partial mu a nu. Okay? That's fine? So yes, you
can do it.
So this thing becomes 0. So I'm left with partial square plus m square equals 0. Now this is just a Klein-Gordon equation. For each component. Now when we look at the Klein-Gordon equation, we know the solution of the Klein-Gordon equation. D these solutions correspond to plane waves. Each plane wave has a certain momentum. It can be expanded as a sum over momentums. Right? It has a certain energy corresponding to the momentums. And the energy dispersion relationship is given by EV equals V squared plus M squared. Now we have a Klein-Gordon equation. This is just a Klein-Gordon equation for each component. So each component gives you particles with a certain mass m. All the masses are the same. And each particle obeys this dispersion relationship as well. Right? So it's the same dispersion relationship for each of the corresponding to each of the four components of the field. Now let's take this description a bit further. What now we would like to do is we would like to canonically quantize this system. In order to perform canonical quantization, as always, we perform the necessary steps. So we find out the first step, of course, is to find out we already have the Lagrangian here. We would now like to find out the canonical momentum by mu. Now we have different kinds of fields here. So this is partial L over partial mu A mu. Okay? So now we have the nth component. So we insert an extra exponent mu. Okay, this is what you've done in one of your homework. And if you perform this here, we've already done it here, you get this thing here. Now if I would like to put this equal to 0, so that's what we require in the commutation relationship, then I will get minus F 0 mu, which is just an electric field. Okay? So, I can find 0 mu. This is non-zero only when mu is 1, 2, or 3. Okay. When mu equals I. So I have pi 0 I. This equals, you already know from our discussion, minus E I. This is the ith component of electric field with a minus sign. Or I could also write this as plus E the downstairs index I. So now the canonical momentum corresponding to a component of the vector potential is just the electric field. But remember, I'm using the electric field as a misnomer. It's not really an electric and a magnetic field. Because this is not electromagnetism. This is at the doorstep of quantum electrodynamics. Okay, so we're just using electric field because the terminology has just stuck to our concept, but it's not really an electric field, it's not electromagnetism that we're talking about. Okay. So now what we would like to do is we would like to construct the Hamiltonian. Now that we have the canonical momentum, yes. So this is just a symbol, right? E is just a symbol. Why you cannot take a voltmeter and take a modulus square and you do not get a voltage out. So it turns out that out of these four components which will emerge, only two are independent. mean to do that.
But local Lagrangian can be already is that for all these in one particles.
This gives you a spin one particle. This is one model that from which emerges a spin one particle.
Spin that Lagrangian value for all the spin one particles.
No, it's not gauging. It's not gauging weighting. So you like to have a gauging weighting. Because gauge invariance is just like a physical principle. You don't want to derive gauge invariance unless you have some special reason to do so. But we haven't yet studied gauge invariance, so I don't want to jump the wagon. Now what we would like to do, we would like to construct the Hamiltonian. Now this is a nice algebraic exercise. If I were to write down the Hamiltonian density, I would like to write down the canonical momentum. Which is this thing here. So I can write minus E let's write E vector and now I have the field A the zeroth component so if I put I equals 0 I equals 0 is being so I get pi 0 0 which is 0 that is being multiplied by a naught which is 0 a naught is not 0 but this is 0 so I just need to find out ei and I'm just composing this as a vector now and I'm taking the three component vector field and I need to take the time derivative of this so I put a dot on top of this. Okay, so this is the first time in the Hamiltonian. And now from this I need to subtract the Lagrangian. So what I'm doing, I'm simply taking this thing, pi, 0, mu, partial, not a mu. That's what I'm doing. This is the first term. No, nu is 0, 1, 2, 3, but the 0 term is 0. Okay. So this is the first term and from this I need to subtract the Lagrangian. Now what is the Lagrangian? The Lagrangian was, is written over here. This first term gives me half e squared minus b squared. So when I subtract this, I get plus half b squared minus half and when I subtract this term over here, I get minus half m squared a mu a. So this is my Hamiltonian. Now let's try this Hamiltonian in a nicer fashion because it has a combination of E's, B's, and A's. Let's try it in terms of E's and B's. That looks more elegant and it can actually make sense out of this kind of thing. So this is fine. This is fine. We have to worry about what we have over here. So A mu, of course this is A naught squared minus A. So I can just put this in here. I will obtain, let's do it stepwise, minus E dotted with A dot plus half B squared minus half E squared minus half n square a naught square plus half m square a vector potential square. Now I need to worry about this term. I need to get rid of this term, and I need to get rid of this term somehow. I need to eliminate a naught from this. Now it is possible to eliminate a naught from this expression, as we will show. So a naught just doesn't appear in our Hamiltonian. Now how do we do that? The thing to observe is the following. We already know that we defined EI. EI was defined previously in one of our previous lectures. This was defined as partial A naught, partial XI minus partial AI over partial time or X naught, right? This is how we are defining EI. Now what I could do is I could write this as partial A naught over partial XI plus, now this is a space like index, let's write this as partial AI over partial X naught. Now what is this? This is just the time derivative of this vector here. Okay. So I can write this thing as E. And if I raise this index, I get minus E minus partial A naught of X. So I can write my H as this minus E instead of this A dot, A vector dot is just this term over here. This term equals EI, which is a lower index, but we would like to have an upper index here. So I make this minus E and this term over here, which is minus. What is this? This is minus del A naught. And then I put in the other terms, half B squared minus half E squared minus half N squared A naught squared plus half M squared A. Okay, so now I have plus E squared here, and this minus half E squared just vanishes. Some of this, so I get half E squared, half B squared, half M squared A squared, and I have this term, and I have this term that I need to take care of. So now what I could do, I could just eliminate A naught from my expression. And how could I do that? If I just look at one of these expressions, I can find out what, I can perform this elimination over here. So, okay, I know this thing is going to be zero. So can I use this to eliminate, or could I use this to eliminate A naught? But this is valid, right? I can use it to eliminate A naught. So if I do that, so if I look at this equation over here, this thing. I have partial mu f mu naught equals over n squared with a minus sign equals k naught. So I know these f's are related to the e's. So this thing is minus 1 over n squared partial I f I naught is a naught. Now this is e I. And this is just the divergence of this. Okay. So this is del dot E. So I have an expression for A naught. So I will replace A naught square with del dot E square with a 1 over m square factor. So I get 1 over m4. I have an m square already here. I get this term. So all of this becomes this. Now I need to worry about this term. What do I do about E dot del? E dot will be del A. I need to worry about this term. I need to take care of this term. Somehow I need to address this nasty little term. Now how do I take care of this term is also quite simple. So if I insert this expression, this entire expression for this expression in here, I will get these two additional terms. Now this is an exact differential. Now if I had this Hamiltonian and I took H equals sum over all volume of this Hamiltonian, and then I applied Stokes theorem, then at the boundary, I will get this term. And if I would like all my fields to be bound at the boundary, if I have a large volume, I would like this field to go to zero. So this term doesn't appear. I can ignore this term because of the finite finitude of my problem. This term, however, will appear. But A naught, you've already found out, is equal to del dot E. So this del dot E is multiplied with itself to give me a del dot E squared term. And I already have a minus sign here. So this is plus. So this gives me an additional plus term, and I'm left with a final nice looking expression for the Hamiltonian, which is simply the following. Thank you. Now I can canonically quantize this number. But I need to know the mode expansions. First of all, let's write down the commutation relationships. So I have my field A. Now I need to talk about some particular component of A. I have pi, which is minus EI. Now this is non-zero only when I have an I here rather than a mean, because for mu equals 0 this term pi 0 is 0. So I have an I here and I must have a j here. This is defined, both of these operators are defined at the same time. This is x, this is y. This commutator is given by iota. X minus y, and these i's and j's have to be the same. So this is my canonical quantization commutation relationship. Now I need to do mode expansion for the a's, which are my field operators. Okay. Now I do a mode expansion in exactly the same fashion as I've done for. For the other case, now, before that, we also know that partial mu A mu for this particular Brocard Lagrangian is 0. And we also can expand these field operators are actually proportional to E to the minus I P of X, right? So the derivative with respect to mu will give me a P mu term. So if this thing is true, then P mu, A mu is also equal to 0. Now this puts a constraint on the p's. This expression puts a constraint on the p's, which means that p naught, a naught, minus p dot a equals 0. Now this means that p naught, a naught is P dot A, which means that I can express my A naught exclusively in terms of the other three components of the vector field. P naught, this is just a time like vector, I can put it up and upspace it instead. So this means that my A naught does not have the independent life of its own. So really I have three polarization states instead of four. Okay, and this is a spin one system. This represents a spin one massive photon because it has three polarization states with Sz equals plus one, zero and minus one. We will talk more about this later in this course, but let me write down the mode expansion for A. Let me expansion over here. So my phi, my A, mu, x, it's a quantum operator, a quantum field operator, A is going to be given by dqp 2 pi 3 by 2 2 ep 1 half. Now what I would like to do is like to have a vector, a four vector, which I denote as E. There are three polarization states. Let's denote the polarization states by lambda. Okay, let me first write down everything and then we'll interpret what's going on. I have three polarization states. With each one of them is denoted by lambda. Lambda takes a value 1, 2, and 3. Now this is a 4 vector over here. So I have this mu can take up 4 vectors. 0, 1, 2, 3. So I have E0. E1, E2, E3. These are components of a 4 vector. Okay, which is called a polarization vector. And there are three kinds of polarization vectors. One has lambda equals 1. So I put a 1 here just to denote the lambda. 1. So this subscript is not a tensorial subscript. It just labels the polarization. So now this is a 4 vector. And with this I have EP1, which denotes the annihilation of particles of polarization, of the polarization of the first kind, with momentum P. Right? With momentum P, but of the first kind. So I put subscript. So this is what this operator now means. I hope this is now clear. So this is the annihilation of operator of momentum P of kind 1 with an E raised to minus I P plus the same polarization vector, but it's complex conjugate. E 0, 1 star E, 1, 1 star E, 2, 1 star E, 3, 1 star A, P, 1 dagger E plus I, P of X. Okay? So this is for the first kind of polarization. Then I have other terms corresponding to the other kinds of polarizations. Let me write this compactly. So my A mu is can be written as D 2 P 2 pi 3 by 2 2 E P 1 half lambda equals 1 2 3. Now this vector, this is the vector. I'm going to write this as E vector. Lambda subscript, which is not a tensorial subscript but is a label for the polarization. I can put a mu with this as well because here I have a mu. AP lambda E minus I P X plus E mu E lambda mu complex conjugate A P lambda dagger E plus I P dot X sum of the four lambdas. So this is the mode expansion for the vector field A mu X. Now if I look at this mode expansion, I can put this into these Hamiltonian, provided I can recast these E's and B's back into the vector potentials. I need to do that. So I need to have a Hamiltonian, an expression for the Hamiltonian, which is exclusively written in terms of A's. And the derivatives of A's, so I can use this mode expansion. Okay, then if I were to use this mode expansion and cranked up all the machinery, once again I will achieve a result of this kind. Okay, now this is not quite easy to see, it's a long tedious calculation, it might take a whole day. But the nice thing is that we can define these vectors, we can put certain restrictions on these vectors. These vectors are orthogonal to one another, which means that I can write the expression E star lambda E star lambda prime. This equals E lambda mu star E mu lambda prime, and here I have G being mu. So if I impose this orthogonality, these vectors obey this orthogonality relationship, and it's immediately obvious that this is equal to minus bracket lambda prime. Okay. So now there are different kinds. You could have linear polarization vectors. You could have circular polarization vectors. Let's leave this to the to our next lecture when we study electromagnetism in some more detail. Yes.
So what